and karaoke, and he's also an ex-stripper. Ex-stripper, can you imagine that? I know, ex-stripper. So please welcome everybody. Oh, by the way, we have a free comedy show over here. If you guys want to eat, come over here. I see people watching, looking. What's that? What's he saying? Who's over there? Is that comedy? Please welcome a good friend of mine, very funny, Mr. Perry Kurtz.
Thank you very much. A round of applause for John. And all the other amazing entertainment you've seen tonight. You've had some great comedians, you had a great time. That's going to come to the screeching halt right now. Hi. My name is Perry Kurtz. I'm going to be your entertainer for a little bit of a while. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. So first of all, my name is Perry Kurtz. That's Perry as in Perry Como. I don't know if any of you remember him. Perry Ellis, clothing designer. Now is a very famous pop singer by the name of Katy Perry. I'm sure you've heard her. She's a woman. I am a man. Don't make me prove that. I proved it last week. She looked at and said, "Oh, you're Jewish." Barely. I'm also older than everybody else on the crew. I'm 66 years old. Thank you very much. Normally people applaud because I'm still alive. That's amazing. I'm 66 and I'm still alive. And in case you're wondering where you are, they decorated this place because obviously people drink a lot when they come in here. And when they have to call their friends, they have to tell them where they are. And they can look on any wall and they can see, I'm in Cabo Wabo, Cabo Wabo, Cabo Cabo, Cabo Cabo, Cabo, it's everywhere. And of course, this is from the song, I Can't Drive 55. You remember that song? A couple years later, he changed it when they upgraded the speed limit to I Can't Drive 65. And now it's much older, and now it's I Can't See 70. Folks, let me tell you. So I'm 66 years old. I'm originally from Philadelphia. Anybody ever heard of Philadelphia? Yeah, Philly's a pretty famous city. It was one of the first cities. They call it a progressive, advanced thinking city. You know, they think they're modern. They're so advanced, yet they haven't fixed the Liberty Bell. A little glue, some sulfur, and put something in. Duct tape, fix that thing. No, no, no. So I'm from there. I left there in 79, moved out to San Francisco to become a comic. But I did leave family behind. I have my brother, who is much younger. He's married. He's got two daughters. So they're all getting married, and they're all having kids. And I have my mother, who is 85. And she's now living in retired living, as they call it, senior living. Or as she likes to call it, the Jewish graveyard for the elephants. It is so boring for people in the senior center. I make all my money entertaining these people. And they get dementia at that age because of boredom. They don't have any social interaction. Nobody talks to each other. It's like a walk up to senior dead in these places. They just walk past it. They don't even know that they're in the room at that time. So my mother's there, and I think she's got dementia. I'm pretty sure because I called her up a couple months ago. I said, "Hi, Mom." "Who's this?" "This is Perry." "Perry? I have a son named Perry." "Yeah, Mom, this is Perry. This is your son." "Oh, okay. Who's calling?" "Mom, this is Perry, your son." "Wow, my son's name is Perry, too." "Do you know Perry?" "Mom, this is Perry." "Okay. Who's calling?" "Mom?" "Yes?" "It's Perry." "Wait a minute, is Perry there?" "Mom, this is Perry. I have a brother named Victor." "You know Victor, too?" So now I go into the immediate stuff, because you go into their past, they lose it. So now I go to right now. "Mom, did you eat today?" "Hold on, let me look in the sink." See, you're laughing because you've done that. You ever get up and you get halfway through the day and you go, "I forgot to eat today." They do this all the time. You see old people shaking? It's because they forget to eat. That's what it is. So she's doing all right. She's a little tiny woman. She was 4'11", now she's 4'10". And she's always had red hair. It's natural, even at her age. It's still naturally red. And when she was growing up, people always told her she looked just like Debbie Reynolds. And she was very excited. And she called me up after Debbie Reynolds died. She said, "I heard Debbie Reynolds is dead." "Great, now who the hell do I look like?" I said, "Tony Fields, Mom. She's dead too." So they're back there. And I moved out to San Francisco in 1979. When I first got there, you really couldn't make any money doing comedy, but I couldn't make any in Philly. That's why I moved out there. One of the first people I got to be friends with was a guy named Robin Williams. Him and I used to do 2 hours of improv every week for 4 years, every Tuesday and Thursday. Became very, very comfortable with him, which is where I really developed my act. I have no material. I just talk about my real life. But I was out there and just working out at the clubs. Got to meet a guy named Bobby Slade, who took me out to a lot of clubs. Became friends with him. Still friends with him. And I went down to Broadway, which is where all the strip clubs are, where all the tourists go. And there was a guy standing out front, parked. People, "Hey, come on in, we got him here, we got a topless, come on in." And he would be pointing, and I got to know one of the guys, and he gave me a job as a barker, that's what they call him. So I would be outside, and people would come by, drive by, and I'd be going. And buses would pull over and come in. Then the MC at the male strip show quit, and they needed an MC for the male strip show because I became the MC and the manager of the male strip club. Now, I gotta say, it's a male strip club. That means it's men dancing for women because it's San Francisco. And single guys were not allowed in unless they were accompanied by a woman because there were a lot of guys in San Francisco in those days where, let's just say, they're very happy. Very happy, very friendly. These are the kind of guys who would bend over forwards for you if you know what I'm talking about. So I get up there every night and I would introduce the dance. I was up there talking dirty with him because you got to keep him out of it. All right, the next guy, that's not even really his left leg. Please welcome to the stage, Big Bobby. You know, and here's the prince and all these things. And after about 6 months, some women started yelling that they wanted me to take it off. Now, this was a blind group of women. But I realized that they saw something that we could not see. A little guy who could dance. And I became a male stripper. And I can move, I can do this stuff. And that's the snake at the end. I don't know why that's so funny, but people just find that hysterical. So I started stripping, and I did really well. I was getting a lot of money because I was a cute little guy. And we would go into the audience to work the room. And the way the club was set up was amphitheater, so the seats went up like that. And at the very top in the back of the room was the spotlight. So if you were in front of people, you were in the dark and they couldn't see what was going on. So I'd be going around, I'd get in front of them, and they would touch you, they would squeeze you. They were very touchy, feely, licky, sucky. They were very friendly in those days, because it was before AIDS. Anybody remember before 1984 when you could touch a vagina and not die? Anybody? God, the good old days. So I did that, and I did that for a couple of years, did that for 4 years, and it was great fun. But while I was there, I got to sit at the family table at Enrico Banducci's, which was a fancy restaurant on Broadway, and they had a big 12-foot marble table out front, where all the celebrities and the club owners and the mafia would sit and eat. I had dinner with mafia members, and I got to know Bill Cosby. Every month, Bill Cosby would come to town with a new box of cigars. And I remember one time he put a cigar in my mouth. I was just waking up, and I think it was a cigar. I don't know, I had a bitter aftertaste. But the thing is, Bill was very nice, and he knew I was a comedian. He told me over and over, it's all about personality. Try and be yourself. Try and life your life. Then you never forget where you are. And a couple years later, I met another guy, a guy named Milton Berle. I don't know if you remember Uncle Milton. He became like a grandfather to me, and through him, I was coming down here to L.A. We would fly down here and I would work at the Friars Club. I got to meet Joey Bishop and Shecky Green and Phyllis Diller and Joan Rivers. And one time I was on stage and Johnny Carson waved at me. I thought, hey, he waved at me. I got a career. So one time I'm having dinner with Bill and Milton and comes in and sits down Rodney Dangerfield. And we hit it off right away. And I told him that I was from Philly. He said, yeah, I live from Philadelphia. I'm actually from there. That's when I was Jack Roy. That was my old name. I was Jack Roy. So we became buddies, and he started flying me out to New York to work at his club, Dangerfield. And I was getting $2,800 a week for four nights. They were doing three shows a night, $25 a head, and it was packed. But I was hanging out with Rodney. Now, if you know this, but Rodney liked to indulge. Yeah. But only when he was awake. Yeah. And he did some coke, probably his body weight. And he smoked a lot of pot. Now, I'm a pot smoker. Anybody here smoke pot, just go, what? Just three of us, the rest of all iron, okay. Well, here's a story about Rodney. I was doing about an hour show, maybe an hour, 5 minutes. And I would get up and I would invite the crowd to talk for a lot of being back there. And then Rodney would go up afterwards and do 10 minutes, and we would go hang out in the back. So he comes up and he says, hey, come here, I want you to meet David. David, this is Perry. It's this 18-year-old boy that he hired to write. He said, yeah, David is going to write for me. He's got me. He gets me. He gets me. And I went, all right, terrific. I hope he enjoys you. He goes, yeah. He says, so he's my new writer. He says, you know what? Let's go up back and smoke a joint. So we go out to the alleyways. Now, the alleyways, back in the clubs in New York, are about as wide as this stage. Room enough for one car to get down the middle, and dumpsters on both sides. And in the middle is all this dirty, oily water from where they dump out the garbage. They would just throw it out there. So we're out there, and we're looking at a dumpster. He pulls out a joint, passes it to the kid. He goes, hey, David, take it. David takes the hit. He passes me. I pass it back to David. Rodney goes, you know what? I got to take a piss. And he turns and starts peeing on the dumpster. I look at the kid. I go, you know what? I got to take a piss. And I start peeing on the dumpster. The kid takes the joint out of his mouth, lays it on the dumpster, takes the dick out, looks at me and goes, this is the best day of my life. Because he's peeing with Rodney Dangerfield.
Oh, yeah.
See, it's all perspective. It's all how you look at things. Like a lot of comics get up there negative. I'm positive about my life. I'm happy. I've had a good life. I've survived this long. You know? Then when 89 came, I got into the Comedy Store. And I said, I'm going to move down to L.A. because my life's going to change. Well, it hasn't changed much, but I did meet my wife. Back in 1991, I met my wife of 25 years. We've been married 25 years now. Thank you very much. The best part is we've been separated for seven. So it's not bad. But when I met her online. Now, back in 91, they had computer dating, but they didn't have color. They didn't have pictures. They didn't, even the letters were just black and white. When you would type a word out, it would build itself dot by dot. It would go boop, 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 boop. That was the P alone. By the time my name finished printing on the screen, my wife made a sandwich, ate it, digested it, and made another sandwich. So we texted each other for a little while. Then she called me and we talked for 40 hours over 3 days. And I fell in love with her over the phone because she has a Southern accent. Anybody from the South? I love Southerners. People have that way. When they talk, they embrace the language. They enjoy speaking. We're in a hurry to get everything out here. People are talking at 100 miles an hour. They don't just say hello. They go, hi. How are you? What's up? They have a drawl. They drawl it out. My wife has a phrase. You always say, but she's leaving. I'm going over yonder. You ever heard that? My wife would go out and she would leave and she went to yonder. I looked at 157 maps. There was no place called yonder. She always came back. So when I met her, we went out for about 6 months. Now in those days I was driving a motorcycle. It was a big blue Kawasaki bike, had a trunk on the back because I didn't have a car. And on the trunk, in big white letters, it said Perrycycle. Are you getting the joke here? People did not. I had people pull up next to me in traffic and roll their window down. Hey, what's a Perrycycle? It's mine. Your name's Perry? Yes, it is. What are you, a comedian? Yes, I am. And they would try to run me over. So in those days, I was working at the Comedy Store full time, working there 7 nights a week. Money was great in those days. And my future wife was hanging out with me. She got to meet everybody. Got to meet Richard Pryor, who I worked with about 7 or 8 times. She met Rodney. She met Milton. She met David Letterman a couple times. Andrew Dice Clay before he was Andrew Dice Clay. Met all the big stars back in those days. And it was great. And then after 6 months, she says, hey, why don't you come to my house? I drove out there. I walk in, there's a guy sitting on the couch, there's a little baby girl crawling around on the floor, there's a little boy and a girl in the corner playing with blocks. So of course, I ask the logical question, honey, who are these kids? And she goes, I guess I forgot to tell you. I have children. And I'm looking at the two doors trying to think which one is getting me out of the house quicker. You ever heard the phrase, don't get involved with somebody that has baggage? My wife owns Samsonite. But I got to know the kids. We all moved in together, and after a year and a half, I learned that the kids did not know their fathers. I was the only man they had ever known in their lives. So one day at dinner, I gave everybody a little gold ring, put it on their fingers, and I got down beside the dining room table, and I said, I'd like to ask you guys to marry me. This is to the kids. And I looked at my wife, to be, and I said, you can join us if you want. And I said, so what do y'all say? Everybody went just like this, except for my son, who went, yeah, whatever, can we just have dessert now? Because boys are so romantic, aren't we? Food? Yeah. So we got married. We got married at City Hall now. I don't know, anybody here ever been married? Anybody out there? Just me, all right. When you get married, usually you have a big wedding. It's fancy, you dress up. You have a band, everybody comes out and dances, and it's a big party. No. We got married at City Hall. The bathrooms here are nicer than City Hall, okay? Everything is gray marble, as bleak as you can be. And I walked in, walked up to the counter, and I had the kids here, and she's over there. And I said, hi, we'd like to get married. And the guy goes, oh yeah, you'd like to get married. I said, no, we'd like to get married. He said, oh yeah, we can marry you. I said, so we can get married? He said, yeah, we do lots of marrying. We marry all the time. Everybody get married here. I said, fine. Can we sign up? He said, sure, yeah, have a seat. We call you when we're ready. So we all go sit down, kids are running around. 20 minutes later, Sarah and Bernie, please come in. We walk in, it's the same guy wearing a judge's robe. And now he's speaking perfect English. The accent had gone out the window with the Rosetta Stone. So he starts reading, he's reading out of the book. He gets to the end, he goes, now Sarah, do you take Bernie to be your lovely wife? She goes, I do. And he goes, and Perry, do you take these people to be your family? And I stupidly said, yeah, I guess so, I'm here, right? See, the women are laughing because they know it was a stupid thing to do. You gotta watch what you do, guys, because here's the problem. Women are smart. When we do something stupid, they remember every stupid thing we do forever. They never forget, and they save it. They save it until the right time when we do something else stupid so they can throw it back in our face to remind us what retards we really are. We just had Without Women Day on Tuesday. I thought that was great. Imagine what life would be without women. We'd all be gay. And society would disappear after a couple years. I think women deserve a lot of credit. They put up with a lot of shit. They go through a lot of aggravation. And the worst part is they sleep with us. And I really, you have my heart for that. The fact that you women have children, that's unbelievable. Holding some inside you for 9 months, there's a joke there and I'm not going after it. So my wife had 3 kids. She wanted to have another kid. I did not want to have another kid because when I grew up in Philadelphia in the 60s and 70s, I smoked marijuana. I did a lot of acid, probably my body weight. And I had heard that if you do drugs, it distorts your chromosomes, so when you have a child, it's born with like an extra arm or a finger growing out of its head. So I was afraid to reproduce. I didn't want to have children. My wife got on the pill. She was on birth control. Then one day she takes me in the bed and says, we gotta talk. So at first I said, great, what did I do this time? She goes, actually you did good. I said, really? She says, yes, I'm pregnant. And I looked and said, any idea who the father is? She didn't laugh. She goes, that's one, don't push your luck. I said, great. She says, get used to it. She left the room and I sat down on the bed and I started freaking out. Oh my God, I can't believe I'm gonna have a child. I'm gonna be an actual father, I'm a comedian. I'm in clubs every night, every single night. This is all I've ever done for 42 years. Only comedy clubs, that's all I know. And I sort of grew into it, but my wife grew into it. I watched her grow into it. I watched her grow. And grow, and grow. She gained 111 pounds. At birth, she was 253. She was so big, so round, that if you pushed her sideways, she would eventually roll back to a standing position. Now, the downside and the upside of her getting pregnant is that when I met her when she was 24, she had very large breasts. They were 45 triple G's. Each one was the size of a soccer ball. And they stood straight out. They were called triple G's because when you would see them, you go, geez, those are some big ditties. But it's great when you're young. See, women always want to have big breasts because they think that's important. But the problem is when you have big ones, gravity takes effect after 10 years. And they start to stretch and stretch and stretch. And now after 25 years, when she sits there with her, sits on a chair, her boobs just roll out on her leg. They look like long water balloons. We would still have booby sex. I would time it and not adjust the tension. Yeah, so, a little over 12 years ago, she tells me that she's pregnant, and I watch her grow and grow, and then 5 weeks before the baby's due, she has horrible pain, and the vein in her head is popping out, and I rush her to the Fitzmaurice Hospital downtown, where we live downtown. Doctor takes me in the other room and says, Mr. Kurtz, we've got 20 minutes to get the baby out of your wife, or she's going to die. And I looked and said, can you give me 30 minutes to think about that? He goes, you don't have the time. Said, we're going to do a cesarean. You're welcome to come in to the operating room during the operation. I said, okay. I walk in. They got her on a table. They got her legs tied up in the air. And he's got her cut open. He has a big slit from one hip to the other. So now she's got two of them. And he's got both hands inside of her. And he's pulling parts out. Like he lost a watch in a drawer. That's how much, and he's talking to the nurses about renting cars to go to Las Vegas. So he's been over, he's going, yeah, so, oh, no, that's not it. So you went to Vegas? That's good, no, that's an intestine. You went to Vegas, who'd you, no, don't you, no, use Enterprise, wait, take my wallet out. There's a card for Enterprise, use that. You go, oh, I think I got her. And I said, is my daughter in there? He goes, hey, this isn't my first rodeo. Do you ever hear that and you want to smack somebody in the face? You don't do that while they're holding your unborn child. He pulls her out and he hands her to me. And she was this big. I could not imagine anything so beautiful in my life. When you have a child, there's nothing as beautiful as looking into the eyes of your firstborn. It's more beautiful than all the sunsets, all the sunrises, all the roses. More beautiful than $1 million of gold cash. And I started to cry, and I'm holding it around, my God, I have a child. And the doctor walks in, he says, Mr. Kurtz, would you like to cut the cord? And I looked at him and said, she's plugged in? He goes, no, the umbilical cord. Oh, you're the comedian. Yes, I am. So he took me over, they put on a little pad table, and they gave me little plastic scissors, little blue scissors. And I go to cut the cord. Now, I thought the cord would just go snip. It's not like this. No, the cord is like this. It's like steel. So I go to cut it and it's going, it's slipping out of the scissors. And I spend 10 minutes chasing this around her stomach and they're hysterical. They're calling their friends. They're on the dial-up phone. Remember dial-up phones? You gotta come see this. They got a camera out, take a picture. Finally comes there and goes, we do that to everybody. And he held it like that. We took her home, named her Bella. But she was beautiful, and she is. She was home 5 weeks, she's in the bassinet. I can walk through the bedroom in the middle of the night, and I hear, and I jump, because I thought the devil was in the house. Because the devil always sounds like it, right? Got that gravelly voice, I'm the devil, I'm Lucifer. I think it'd be a lot more interesting if the devil sounded like Ethel Merman, had a pink jumpsuit, came out just dancing. There's no business like soul business. So I keep walking, then I hear it again. And a smell hit me and my eyelashes burst into flames and I fell to the floor. I crawled in the bed choking and I woke my wife up. Honey, what is that horrible smell that came out of the baby? She goes, oh, I forgot to tell you, it's baby food. We give it to him at night and it gets the gases out while they're sleeping. They go, I wish you told me about that, because I can't inhale anymore. couple nights later, we're watching TV, the whole family, watching a Disney movie. And my wife says, I'm going to watch a cop movie. And I didn't really like that at first. I should wait till the end. You know, you got DVRs. Wait a little while. So I got even. I waited until she was sleeping. And then I ate some baby food. And I waited about a half hour until my stomach was going. And I crawled into bed. I woke her up. I said, honey, pull my finger. She pulled my finger. I went, oh my God, what's that horrible smell? I said, baby food. Now my little baby is older. My little Bella is 12 years old. Very, very proud of her. Drew. By the way, have a round of applause for Drew. Drew is my best friend for 12 years. He's been my daughter since before she was born. In fact, she does look a little like you. No, she looks just like me. She really does. It's weird. She really does. And now she's just tall, and she's worried she's going to be short. I said, you're going to be taller than I am. You see, my father was 5'8", my wife's father was 6'4". And they say it skips a generation. She's going to be like 6 feet tall. But she's smart, she's beautiful, and I know she's beautiful because we do a lot of karaoke together. She loves to sing. And I have a special talent, which I'll show you in a little while. Well, I take her out to karaoke bars, and when we come up, do the same thing. Your daughter is so pretty. Your wife must be stunning. Do I get any credit for being there? As my wife says, it was the best 10 seconds of her life. I said, 10 seconds, and we do it twice? So we go out, she sings. She also does stand-up comedy. She writes jokes. Her latest joke, which she wrote about a month ago, I don't understand why Trump is so against immigration. If it wasn't for immigration, he wouldn't have any wives. Woo! So she's done a lot of shows with me. She's done stand-up at the Comedy Store, snuck her on stage there once. I got yelled at her because she's not allowed to be on that stage. But I snuck her up there. And now, as I said, I'm making all my money playing at senior centers and convalescent hospitals. Now, senior centers are great because these people are bored and they're thrilled to have somebody who talks to them. And I talk to them. I say, who's got a birthday here? And someone will volunteer and I go, what's your name? Where are you from? There's always a joke about that. I was in San Diego. I did a show and I said, all right, who's got a birthday? And then he goes, I do. I said, great, what's your name? She goes, Zita. I go, Rita? She goes, Zita, you stupid schmuck. I said, all right, Zita, when's your birthday? She goes, it's today. I said, today, are you from New York? She goes, damn straight I am. I go, so your birthday today? She goes, yeah. I said, how old are you? She goes, today, I'm 85, and these are 10 years old. Now there's glassware on the floor. Everybody's laughing. When the old people laugh, they bounce. They over. PTE. And with the old people, you have to let them settle down before you start talking. Because if they're laughing, they can't listen at the same time. They can only do one thing at a time. You don't see them talking and walking. So I let him settle down. I said, listen, Zena, I got to ask you, what was it that 10 years ago you decided you needed to replenish? And she thinks for a second, and she grabs them and bounces them up down. She goes, hey, they're very popular here. Crowd's hysterical again. I let him settle down. I took a drink. They're still laughing. I took another drink. They're still laughing. I refilled my glass. They're still laughing. From the back of the room. Hey, she's got great boobs for an old broad, ain't she? Yeah. So they're fun. They have different things to say. I had one couple sitting right up front. She had her hand on his leg. So I figured they were together. So I said, are you guys a couple? She goes, whatever. Yeah. I said, how long have you been together? She goes, 54 years. That's pretty good. How long have you been married? She goes, 4 years. So you knew each other for 50 years and then you got married. What made you rush into this? She said we were waiting for our spouses to die. See, that's it, they're burning macabre. They all recognize death is right around the corner. And so they will say anything they want. They have no compunction about saying horrible, mean things. They blurt out stuff. They're insane, but they're a lot of fun because of that. So I enjoy working these rooms. Now, the other end of the spectrum is the convalescent hospitals. These are people all in wheelchairs. They have been rolled in. Some of them don't even know they're in the room. And they tend to fall asleep suddenly. They'll be sitting there and all of a sudden in the back of the room you hear. Oh, I had one lady sitting right next to me tearing up her paper tablecloth thing. I need help with this. I need help. But the thing is, when you get them laughing, they're very, very happy. They're built to death, and that's the best part. Now, I've taken my daughter with to a couple of shows. When she was 6 years old, her first joke was, why did the chicken cross the road? He was tired of being cooped up. At seven, why was the skeleton afraid to cross the road? He had no guts. When she was eight, her closing joke, why did the rooster cross the road? The chicken was on vacation. So she is the best thing in my life, and I wanted to bring her with tonight. But it's a school night. My daughter's now a cheerleader.
Yeah,
so I'm getting on birth control tomorrow. No. She told me not to worry about that stuff. When she was 10, we were driving, and in those days, my maker sit in the back seat. And we're driving, and she looks at me, and she says, hey, Dad, I got a boyfriend. I said, you're 10. What do you mean you got a boyfriend? She goes, well, he's just a fat kid who does what I tell him. I said, so you got yourself a bitch. She goes, I didn't want to say that. I go, great. Well, be careful. She said, don't worry. When I start dating, I'm going to practice anal. I hit the brake so hard, she choked on the seatbelt. She's like, ugh. I said, you deserve that. She goes, I'm kidding, Dad. I'm not going to practice. What? And she points at me and goes, gotcha. So she is just the best kid ever. Anybody here have children that you know of? Anybody with children? No? I did a show a couple weeks ago, I asked that. And I said, anybody here with children? You guys are fundraising. And I said, really, you have kids? He goes, yeah. I said, how many? He says, two. I said, they're from different ones. He said, no, the same person, same woman. I said, you had two kids from the same mother? Wow, in L.A., that's like a callback. So things are changing for me. I've moved out of L.A. proper. I'm now living out in the far end of the valley. I'm living in Pacoima. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of Pacoima. I looked it up. The exact translation is no white people. I drive down the street slow and people go. And then he say something really fast at a high pitch and I don't understand what the hell they're saying. And then I buy a piece of corn and I drive home. But we're right off of San Fernando Road and there's an alley between us and the car lot. And there's a lot of activity in that alleyway. And there's an airport on the other side of the street with a railroad track and two heliports. So the sound is unbelievable. So I got two pieces of wood and I put that in the window and I put bubble wrap in back of it. I heard that bubble wrap is the best sound stopper because the bubbles vibrate and it absorbs the sound. And it works. But one day I was in my room and I heard, pull over, get out of the vehicle. And I hear, and sirens are going off. So I don't know what's going on. I forgot about it. I go to leave. Now, our house, as I've noticed, all the houses in Pacoima, they all have a fence. Every house in Pacoima has a fence around the house. I don't know, to keep people out or to keep people in. I'm not sure what it's for. But ours is padlocked, so I unlock the lock and I pull out in the driveway. And there's police at this end of the driveway and police at the end, like 25 cars. They're the SUVs, they're the white cars, they're the black cars, they're black and white cars. There's cops all over. As I pull up, cop walks up and bangs on my window. Get out of the car. So I get out, put the keys on the dashboard, which is what you should do if you get pulled over. Put on the dashboard, it's respect. And I get out and I go like this, he goes, where are you going? I go, I'm going to do a club. He goes, well, did you see anything out here? I said, well, no. He said, did you hear anything? I said, oh, I heard a screech, and I heard the police say, pull over and get out of the car. I said, and you didn't look out your window to see anything? I go, this is Pacoima. You don't look out your window here. He looks at me and goes, hey, you're good. Get out of here. You know. So. But I get pulled over by the police a lot because I tend to drive fast. My average speed is 80. I'm very comfortable. But I drive a Volkswagen, and it's strange because I'm Jewish. I'm driving a German car. It's the German revenge. When I first got the car, I turned on the motor and went, I know nothing! And gas came out of the vents. Cleared that out now. So I get pulled over a lot for speeding. And when they pull me over, I always do the same thing. I always smile, and that's the best thing. Be nice to them. Be pleasant. Act like you're lost. That works really. I'm really not sure where I was going. do you know where this is? Sometimes they'll just give you an address and let you go. But with me, they usually say, where are you going? I go, well, I'm a comedian. And they go, oh, really? You're a comedian? Yeah. And they shake their head at me. And then they go, all right, make me laugh. And I look at them and I say, F you. Not the letters, I say the actual words. And they laugh. And they go, oh, I can't believe you said that. All right, yeah, you got some big balls, man. All right, slow down, drive, take care of you. And they let me go. Now, one time I got pulled over in Riverside, under the freeway. Now, I don't know if you know what Riverside is. It's where they grow meth. That's where my daughter said. And she said that, Dad, we were in Riverside. They grow meth out there. I go, well, it's close enough. But the cops out there, they don't mess with you because there's a lot of guns in Riverside. So I got pulled over. And the cop pulled me over underneath the freeway because there was nowhere else to go. We were under the 60 and the 215 and one other freeway there. And he comes around to the right side of the car because he can't stand here because the car's going by. He sticks his head in and he's got thick curly hair, big blue eyes, big cheekbones, amazing white teeth and a cleft in his chin. He looks like the first Tarzan. And he sticks his face in. He goes, hi, how you doing? I go, God, you are the best looking cop I've ever seen, and I'm not even gay. And he laughed, and he smashed his head on the room. I go, no, that's pretty funny. He goes, where are you going? I said, I'm a comedian. He goes, really? And I said, well, you know, you love my God. He goes, no, tell me a joke. I said, all right, I don't do jokes, but here's one. Here's these two guys sitting in a bar in West Hollywood. One of them says the other one, there's some red fluid leaking out of my car. And his friend says, well, you're probably going to have to pull the tranny out of it. And he looks and he goes, can't I just open the door and tell him to get out of the car? And he laughed, that's a good one. He said, do you know why I pulled you over? I said, because I was doing 93. He said, no, could you cut me out 3 times in a row? And I thought that was enough. And he let me go. So I'm very happy to be alive. Like I said, I'm 66, I'm still alive. Although I am getting a little bit warm. Can everybody see me in the jacket? Yeah, Liberace's dead, but I got his jacket. On weekends, I rent myself up as a mirror ball. So if you got a flashlight, I can turn on. Problem with the jacket, though, is although it's very cool, and it's one of a kind, there are no other men that seem to have this jacket. Last year I went to an Emmy party, and 300 people came up to me. Can I touch that? So it's a great jacket, but these are metallic, and they're very warm. So I'm going to, as they say in the business, I'm going to take it off. So ladies, please relax. You, sir, don't get too excited. Here we go. One, two, three. That's what I'm allowed to do because they serve food here. Thank you for getting that. Any questions so far? How many people are still here right now? How many people are here? All right. How many people don't know where you are? How many don't give a damn? How many people here in the past week have had sex? A little bit quiet there. He's looking at her to confer. That's good. How many had sex with another person? Anybody at all? Cut the numbers down drastically. That's good. And this guy's too tired to even lift that hand up. That's okay. Whatever makes you happy. Whatever floats your boat, as they say. Oh, well, this is nice. I'm glad you guys came down for this big fiasco. And, don't forget your bartenders. I mean, we don't have any. I think we have some table service. But be generous and support the club. Come back here. You're in Hollywood Highland. There's always stuff happening here. Let's hear for three gay guys walking by. Ted always gets a laugh. All right, well, I'm going to do something for you to really wrap it up here. I know you are a wild rock and roll club. And so I'm going to grab my axe, and we're going to kick it up a notch. This is a keytar. It's called a keytar because it's a combination of a guitar and a keyboard. Get it? Very simple. Now, what's great about it is it's got stuff to go right in. You don't have to know how to play. Turn it on, hit a button, and you're playing rhythm and blues. And when you're done, and you want to wrap up the song, put this in 25 years ago. I found it in a Ralph's Market above the freezer section. Have you ever looked up above the freezer section? There is stuff in there that you didn't even know existed, such as this. I saw an 11-slice toaster. Now, how much pot you gotta smoke that you think you need one more than 10 and one less than 12? 11 slices. But I guess, you know, when you smoke pot, it does make you do stupid things. Never ever smoke a joint and go food shopping. I did that once. I spent $135 and all I got was butter. But I got this thing for $25 and we had become good friends. Another thing I found, this is, this sounds like a scary movie. And you know somebody's gonna die when you hear this. Why do they always have that one woman trip? And you know she's gonna trip, because she's running like this. She looks like a penguin on crack. So what I wanna do with this now is I wanna do a song that you guys all know, and I'm hoping you will sing with me. It's a song called Louie Louie. Now, nobody really remembers the lyrics, because when the guys recorded it, they were drunk off their asses. They're interviewed. A couple years ago, they said, we were drunk, we don't remember what we actually said. But the thing people do remember, which is what I want you to sing, is Louie Louie, oh baby, we gotta go now. I said, a Louie Louie, oh baby, we gotta go now. All right, you got all that? Very simple, yeah. And I'll coach you. The rest of the song, you're just gonna have to wait and see. So here you go. Guess what? I don't really know. I look up at the basketball game. The Thunder is playing. He's slowing down. He shoots it. You get it? I'm saying. He got the ball in his number 021. He's running to the end. He's gonna shoot the gun. He passed it to the center. And he takes his shot. He didn't get it. Well, he gave up everything that he's got. I said, Louie Louie. And try to make it rhyme. My friend Bruce sitting there, and he's actually sitting there on his phone. He's not really doing anything because there's nobody waiting for him at home. Oh, I said, and he said it too. I'm glad to see the both of you. I didn't think you'd actually come down, but you're here, and that's really cool. I'm up here trying to do this stuff and not look like a fool. Come on and do it. Simple, open, automated, effective. I'm up here trying to do it, and the baby smile. What the heck is going on in Cisco? On March 24, these guys are walking. He's got a gun, who knows what for? And he looks upset, and he said, get set. I'm up here, and we're going to do it here, you bet. That's right. Anybody want to dance? Just me? You guys, if you're gonna have sex, please have safe sex. Because they say if you have unsafe sex, you have a 1 in 100,000 chance of getting AIDS. The way I've seen it, if you're sleeping with your 99,000 sex partner, you need to slow the hell down. Alright, now I'm gonna do my big close, and it's a thing I call karaoke. It's a special technique I've developed. As they say on TV, do not try this. Very good. Here we go. Mm-hmm. sound like Daffy Duck. Quack, quack, quack. All right, last time, you ready? Real loud, everybody sing it now.
You and I, oh baby, we gotta go now.
Aye, aye, aye. Sex with more people than we have in the room today. No. Just remember, if you're driving home, and I know a lot of you will be, please be careful. A lot of people will be driving drunk, so if you're driving, drive as fast as you can. It's much harder for me to hit you. You can find me at partyfunny.com. Look me up there. Look me up on YouTube at Perry Kurtz. Otherwise, you guys have been a lot of fun. Thank you so much for being here. And have yourself a really good night.